Hi everyone, welcome to Google Search Basics webinar. My name is Tanay Bobde and I'm a strategic partner manager at Google and I'll be your host for this session. I hope all of you are doing well and are staying safe. Given the current limitations, we are actually bringing Search Basics to you via this online opportunity. It'll definitely not be as good as seeing and engaging with you all in person, but we are grateful that so many of you have actually showed up today. So thanks for that. And before we get started, I actually want to share a few housekeeping notes. There are two broad sections in this webinar. The first session will involve presentation and talks by our amazing speakers, and the second one will be around live question and answers. To ensure everyone can watch the talk smoothly without any interruption and to avoid any technical issues, the first section on talks is actually pre-recorded. And the second section actually on question and answers will be a live broadcast. I would encourage all of you to post questions in the Q&A section on the site. You'll actually see the Q&A section at the bottom of this video. Everyone watching this webinar can actually see your questions and can like your questions to upload. The questions will go through our admin and hence it might take time to show up. So it'll be great if you can just be a little patient around that point. But yeah, with that, we can actually get started. So today, actually, we are starting a presentation by bringing you back to 1998, when you probably used Google Search for the first time. That moment for many of us was very magical because all of a sudden, all the world's information was right at your fingertips. And if you flash forward today, that model has actually completely changed. Mobile and many more devices have forever changed how we live our daily lives, as well as how we do business. People are connected all day, every day to essentially all of the world's information. What hasn't changed is that search is still the place we go to find useful, relevant, and actionable information. Whenever you want to know something, buy something, or go somewhere, search is where you actually go to. That actually brings us to trillions of searches each year. And that is why we can easily say that search has become part of our business and our daily life. Search remains one of the best ways for our users or customers to discover your business or content online. And therefore, we are here today to talk about Google Search and how you can manage your website's presence here. We have an exciting agenda for you today with some amazing speakers. We have Ashish, who is a product support manager, who will walk us through how Google Search works. Basically, what happens in that split second when you type a query on Google Search and see results. We have Himani, who is strategic partnerships development manager, who will talk us about features on Google Search and give us a sneak peek into the world of rich results. We will then have Jyotika, who is a senior strategist. Jyotika will share more on Google Search Console and also five things that you should do in general to sort of help you succeed on Google Search. We also have a couple of guest speakers. We'll have Daniel Marshak, who's product manager of videos in search, as well as Asuka Kim, who's product partnerships manager for videos in search. With that, we can get started and I'll hand it over to Ashish to just share on how Google Search works. Over to you, Ashish.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining the How Search Works session. I'm Ashish Marina. I'm the product support manager for Webmasters in GUP in Google. All right, so just like Tanay mentioned, I'm sure you all know how Google Search looked in 1998. In fact, you can actually try and get this page by typing Google in 1998 in your browser. It would take you back 22 years to how Google was then. So based on how Google search results are there now, I'm sure you've seen like a lot of change, but one thing that's remained constant and one thing that's not changed over the past over 20 years is Google's mission. And Google's mission has started with and has always been to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful, which basically means all the information that we've organized, everybody can access it, and they can access it in a very meaningful and useful manner. This commitment remains the same in today's world, where users are consuming content in more moments and more devices than before. So we've also improved Google Search over time to help users get the information they're looking for in the most convenient and fastest way. So if you're in your car, you can look up Android Auto and ask Google for, hey, play my Hindi playlist or something. And then if you're in your kitchen and you want to cook up some recipe for palak paneer, you can ask your Google Home device and Google Search will provide you directly the recipe, and it will even read out the instructions for voice search if you go through voice search. And similarly on your phone, if you're looking to buy a product or buy, say, good tea, you can ask for where to buy tea and you will directly get local results that for shops around you that you can immediately go and look up and buy. And all of search has evolved a lot. In fact, like just from this slide, you can see that the image search if you click on certain product images, you can directly look at a lot of product information related to how much that particular product costs, whether it's in stock or not. And you can even directly go and buy products directly from image search. And similarly, Google Discover shows you a lot of relevant content that's related to your searches. And then you've also get a lot of actionable and actions related searches from your Google Assistant. So with all these kinds of different information that Google is providing you, sometimes you may tend to forget that there's a whole process and there's a whole mechanism behind how Google is doing this. So in this presentation, we are going to bring you back to the basics of how search works. We believe that this should be actually able to help you understand what goes on in the background of that split second when you enter a query on Google Search. How is Google bringing you all that relevant information in microseconds? We think that by understanding all of how search works, you'll actually be able to manage your website presence better, because you would know, okay, what is Google looking for? How do I provide my content properly so that Google understands it and provides it to the user in the right manner? All right, the one key important thing to note, and this is very important, just so that it's very clear, before anything else, Google Search, organic results are completely separate from the ads. And for organic results, Google does not accept any kind of payment. Like you can't pay to appear at some top first or second of organic search results. They are completely based on our algorithms. And we present those results just based on user's query and how relevant the content is to a user's query. It doesn't have anything to do with anybody paying to get to the top of our search results. And this is different from ads, where you can actually pay to show up in ads. So how does search work? With search, there are three main important steps that concern how search works. They're crawling, indexing, and ranking. And your level of control for each of these three particular steps is very different. And like the problems that you may face with regards to how Google is accessing your, crawling your website, how Google is indexing your website, and how Google is ranking your content, the level of control you have at each of these stages is different. So you should be aware of both what are these steps and how much level of control you have while you're creating your online presence and while you're troubleshooting any issues that you have. So the first step is crawling. We'll look at crawling first. And in crawling, what happens is Google accesses a lot of pages on the web through a robot called Googlebot. It is similar to how you access pages on the web through your browser by typing in a particular URL. So Google does the same thing. It goes to a different URLs using a robot called Googlebot. And for search, those websites, what are websites that we consider for search? They are any content that's hosted with URLs on the web. And a few things that are important is that content that's hosted, it has to be publicly accessible. It can't be under a 403 forbidden page, or it can't be password protected or something. It has to be publicly accessible. And it also has to allow Google to index their pages. So it's not just that you can access it on a browser. That the page should also make sure Google can access the page and also can index that particular page. And finally, it should be viewable in all modern browsers. So because if Google can access it, but users can't access it, that's not really very user-friendly. So Google will not really consider that page for indexing in our index. Let's see some examples of what search considers a website. So any HTML page, which is most of the common websites are built out of HTML, and any pages from that are part of content management systems and blogs like WordPress, Blogger, and so on. And even social media pages, these are also pretty much websites. A lot of people have their e-commerce or their local store website web pages on social media, and those pages are considered as websites too. And there's also these fancy progressive web apps where you can even have some offline functionality. Those pages are considered as websites too. And even pages that sites that are made with frameworks that with complex JavaScript like AMP, Angular, React, all of those are considered as websites too. So Google can crawl all of these content. So I think Tanay showed you that, like, you know, there are trillions of searches that are happening, right? So how many web pages are there in this world? Does anyone know? Well, actually, even we don't know the right number, because remember how we told you, you know, we discover content on the internet by sending Googlebot to look for pages out there. Well, Googlebot needs to, we only know how many pages are there based on how many pages Googlebot has actually crawled and seen, which is roughly over 130 trillion pages. But there's a lot more content on the web that we have not yet crawled. Some of the content is not accessible. So all of that content, we honestly don't know how many pages are there. But from our estimate, we know over 130 trillion pages. So this basically means that Googlebot is very busy crawling the internet for pages to index for search. Because it's not just that we crawl these pages once and we stop. We have to keep crawling many of these pages because the content gets updated and we need to show the updated information for our users. So say you just created your website, right? Yeah, Google doesn't know because, like I said, Googlebot is busy crawling. There's trillions of pages on the web. And how does Googlebot know that you've created your website? And how does Googlebot know that there's this new homepage that's out there on the web? Well, one of the simplest ways you can let Googlebot know is through a link, from an existing page that Googlebot already knows. If you link your website through that existing page, Googlebot can crawl your website and find out and access and index your website based on that. There are, of course, like a lot of other ways too. Link is the most common and typical way, but there are a lot of other ways where in Search Console, there's this tool called Search Console where you can submit your URL for indexing and crawling, or you can even submit a sitemap, which is a map of all the URLs in your site. It's a file, mostly people use XML, but yeah, it's a file of all the URLs in your site. You can submit that in Search Console, and the Search Console bit will later be covered by Jyotika in this presentation. So once Googlebot has crawled your homepage, there are a lot of other pages in your website, and Google can only access them if you've properly done the internal linking. So from your homepage, if you can actually link to all the internal pages of your site, and from there link to all the proper products in a very structured manner, Google can actually go and crawl all the content on your page. So Googlebot is happy, you are happy, the content is there on the web, and this is the beginning of what could be called like a beautiful relationship. All right, some points or things to note with regards to crawling. So yes, Googlebot crawls the web. We crawl over 20 billion pages per day. We could crawl even more, but thing is there's limited bandwidth for lots of websites. If we crawl a website too many times, we could even like crash those websites. So we are generally very sensible with how we crawl the web. So we use scheduling mechanisms depending upon like the type of content, how you tell us what your content is, and so on. We schedule our crawling so that we don't crash any websites. We keep the web safe and safe and secure. And for you, this basically means like not all your content will be crawled immediately. So if you create a new content, if you add like 10 new pages to your website, it could take some time for those pages to be crawled. You can tell us about the most important content on your website, so we prioritize and we make sure that gets crawled faster. And we'll cover that in our last presentation again in the Search Console presentation on how you can do that. And another thing to note is, if you remember, we mentioned, like, you know, it's not just what's publicly accessible, but what's also the pages that Google you allow Google to access and you allow Google to index. So there's this file called robots.txt. So if you feel there's content on your website that Googlebot does not need to index, whether that content, whether it is because that content is not useful for others to know, or whether it's simply because those pages don't really add value to your website and it's a waste of bandwidth for Google to crawl those pages, you can add those URLs or directories of your website in robots.txt and tell Google to not crawl those pages. All right, now that we've gone through crawling, so now that Google has crawled your website, you know, Google has clearly understood, like, okay, this is the content on your website. The second step is we index your website. So the second step is indexing. And Google's index, we don't have multiple indexes. We just have like one big index. We don't have like different indexes for like mobile pages, desktop pages. No, we just have like one single index. So all the copies of pages after we crawl, we store them in the index. But even though our index is super huge, it's not limitless. We still need to be efficient. So we try to index only the most valuable pages. What this means for you is if you have duplicate content, if you have like the same content on 5 to 6 different pages, then Google will probably index only one of those pages, because it's a waste of our resources to index the same content 6 times, right? So what we do is we index one page and we tell that, hey, these 5 other pages are duplicates of this particular page. So that way we are more efficient. And what this also means for you is you should focus on your content and make sure each and every page on your website is adding value to users and it's not the same content repeated over and over. And in the indexing step, we also do a lot of other things. We also annotate pages with a lot of different signals, like what kind of links that what kind of links those pages are getting, what kind of content is there on the page, what kind of how old that particular page is, and so on. So after we annotate, we also render a page. What this basically means is we don't just look at the words on that particular page. We are able to also render that page, and if there are any JavaScript actions or whatever, we can do that, and we can understand much more than just words on your particular page. Okay, now let's try to apply what we've understood so far. Like, you know, Google crawl your page and Google index your page. But one of the most common questions that most people get is like, why is my site not on Google? Of course, even more people will ask you, why am I not number one? But why is my site not on Google is also one of the most common questions. So if you are like wondering the same question, I think one of the simplest ways you can just give a quick check to how your site is there on Google's index is by using the site operator search, which is nothing but typing site colon and your website URL in Google search. So what that does is Google, in Google search, all the pages that are indexed under that particular website, Google shows you those pages. It doesn't show you the exhaustive list, but it gives you a glimpse of all the pages under that particular website. So you can, like, you know, you can just give a quick check of, okay, is my website indexed in Google or not? And this only pertains to indexing, as in whether the page is there in the index or not. This does not really have any value in terms of like ranking. So just because your website is there in the Google's index doesn't mean it will always rank for all the queries that you want. This is an example search result. Now that we've seen, we've seen that, okay, your page is in the index, but just being in the index is not very useful. Just showing up as a search result is not really useful. You have to be showing useful information through your search result. In this example, what's happening here is like, I as a user, I can't really tell what this search result is about. I can see that like homepage, but I don't know what this homepage is about, and the description doesn't really give me any extra information either. So this is one common mistake a lot of people make, where they have, it may not be as blatant as this, but they may not have like useful information showing in the title or the description of a page. And a lot of users, if they don't see useful information in the title or snippet, they may like, you know, pass your search result and go to the next search result that gives them the right information. So here's an example of a good search result where there's a clear and unique title, which tells us, okay, this page is about all the resources to track my website and search performance. And the description elaborates that by saying, hey, if you want to be found on Google Search, we are here to help. You can track your site's performance on Google Search Console. And you also can find a lot of additional webmaster resources here. So with this, I get a good idea of like what this page is going to be. And as a user, I'm like, you know, if this is relevant to my search result, I'm happy to click it. And this is, if you are familiar with just source code, you can, a very simple way to just make edits here is just look at the title tags and the meta description tags. And just if you feel like your search result is not showing clearly enough, you can go here and make those changes. But of course, like if you're not familiar, you can check with your the people who develop your website, or in case you have like a CMS or a blog, in many cases, there's like UI options. You should be able to find options within your user interface to actually make the changes and add the right title and description if it's not already good. All right, now that we've gone through crawling and indexing, we've come to the final piece, the third piece, which is ranking. Ranking is not only the most visible part of how search works, but it's also one of the most complex tasks, because we have this huge index. And for your query, we have to bring you the top relevant results in a matter of like microseconds. So this is one of the most complex tasks. And we employ more than 200 signals to figure out, OK, how do we best serve a user's need? We take a lot of things into consideration. One of the biggest things into consideration is the query itself. OK, how relevant are the pages that we are bringing to the user's query? And then there's a lot of other factors. Like for each particular user, there's different information we take into account, like where that particular user is, like location, what are those user preferences? And you know, if that user has given permission for us to use those preferences, like, you know, what are those user preferences? What kind of device they're on? Like, for example, a mobile search result could differ from a desktop search result. So this basically means even in the same room, two people searching for the same query may actually see slightly different results. So now that we've gone through the basics of how search works, I also want to recap and bring you like some basic things that you can do for your better presence on Google Search. The first thing you can do is focus on users. So I think this is a mantra for Google in general, but not just for Google. Any webmaster, any website website owner, content creator, this is like the first thing that they need to keep in mind, which is focus on the user. It might be weird. We are now talking about like search and all that, and I'm telling you to focus on users instead of just like, you know, optimize for search engine. But thing is, the search engine itself is built for users. And if a page is not focusing on the users, Google doesn't really want to show those particular pages. So a few tips with regards to focusing on users. First thing is build your website with purpose. Don't really look for creating content that website that search engines may rank, but rather look to create content that users may find relevant and users may need. Like, you know, learn about personas, write in their language, and think about like their goals and conversions. And secondly, give your users a safe and secure experience. Make sure you have HTTPS secure on your site, and make sure there's no issues like mixed content, like not just your site doesn't just have HTTPS, but all the resources on your site are also secure, so that your users are not even by mistake downloading like a third party malicious file or something like that. And always use security best practices to prevent your site being hacked. And even if your site is hacked, as we will be seeing in Search Console later, make sure you sign up for Search Console alerts and everything so that you can immediately fix issues and make sure your users don't have a bad experience. And finally, This is even more important in the mobile world where sometimes connections are not great. You need to make your website super fast. And especially with mobiles, you need to make it very accessible. So what does accessible mean? It basically means you need to provide a good user experience. So if you go to in Search Console, you'll see this mobile usability report, or you'll even see this mobile friendly tool of Google's. You can simply type mobile friendly tool and you'll see like what are the key important things with regards to usability that you need to keep in mind. And with good user experience, not only do users get engaged with your site better, you also have like a ranking related benefit, which is if your website is fast and if your website is friendly for mobile, these are ranking factors that will help your site on search. So if there are two pages that have same good content, but one page is loading very slowly, Google may prefer to rank the faster page higher because that's a better experience for users. But how do you know your site is fast and loading well on all devices? Well, we have a bunch of tools that you can use online easily. So there's these two tools called PageSpeed Insights and Lighthouse. With Lighthouse, you can actually install it as an extension too. And with PageSpeed Insights, you can it's just a simple URL. You can just type your website URL, and it will give you a list of all the things that that are working for you, that are not working for you. What is the most impactful changes that you can make to make your website very quick and so on. So you can just after the session, you can just type PageSpeed Insights, and you can just use this tool to see what are the main improvement opportunities you have for your website and try and fix them. And another thing that we are considering in the near future is page experience. So it's we've already talked about mobile friendliness and making sure your site is secure. And a couple of things regarding secure is make sure there are no intrusive interstitials, which basically means in your mobile browser, if somebody's searching for a page, and as soon as they click on the page, there's this huge dialog box with 20% off some voucher or something, then that is, unless you sign up for that voucher or whatever, it doesn't let you access the content on the page. That is an intrusive interstitial. So these are some of the things that we are already considering as bad experiences for users. But other than that, we've recently launched, the Chrome team has launched Core Web Vitals. These are a set of metrics related to speed, responsiveness, and visual stability to help site owners measure their user experience on the web. So from search, we are combining the signals derived from the Core Web Vitals, which is, like I said, speed, responsiveness, and visual stability. And we're combining them with the existing search signals that we've talked about previously, which is mobile friendliness, secure site by HTTPS, and not having any intrusive interstitials. We're combining the Core Web Vitals and these signals. And we are trying to provide a holistic picture of page experience. And this page experience benchmark, we're planning to make this one of the many search ranking factors, like we said, 200 factors, right? So we're planning to make page experience as one of the many factors starting from mid-year next year, May 2021. So PageSpeed Insights and Lighthouse, like I've shown you previously, those tools are a good start for you to just go and check, okay, is there anything I need to fix? Is there some low-hanging fruit that I can immediately fix to make my site speed and mobile and usability experience faster and better for users? Right. Now that we've covered the user part, then we need to also look at making sure you're communicating more and getting insights from the data that Google is providing. So by communicating more, what I mean is there's a lot of resources that Google provides for website owners on the web. So you want to make sure you know what those resources are, you ask questions, you participate in events and so on, just to understand, okay, how do I improve my site better? What are the better insights that I can get from Google's tools and resources? And if there's some fixes I need to make, whom do I talk to and so on? And the first thing that to keep in mind is the biggest and best tool that Google provides you in this regard is Google Search Console, which is a tool that gives you all the data related to how you're doing on Google organic search. It can also do many things, you can track your site's performance on search, how many clicks you have from search to your websites, how many impressions you have, how you're ranking. You can also look at, okay, if there are any manual actions or any security related actions for your website and so on. This will be covered in much more detail in the last talk today, so stay tuned for that. And if you have any questions, one great place to ask in-depth questions, and also not just ask questions, but also look at similar questions that were already asked and look at the great answers that are already out there in the Search Central Help community. So you can just go to type Search Central Help community, and there are a bunch of questions that are already asked. So if you have any doubts related to, like, how do I rank better? What am I doing wrong? All of that, there are a lot of great product experts who can help you with these things. And if you also want to, we organize a lot of events. This year, unfortunately, like because of the pandemic, we are doing a lot of digital events. But in the last few years, we've launched some particular global events like the Webmaster Conference, and there've been events like the Google Dance. So we are doing a lot of things online. Like we even have like a great YouTube channel that covers a lot of topics from single page apps SEO to a really cool series for Search Console by Daniel. And then we also have like Google Search News on a monthly basis by John Mueller. So we are having a lot of content, a lot of updates through our Twitter, Google Search Central Twitter channel. So you definitely want to join and sign up for these events and these subscribe to these channels to make sure you're up to date and you can ask any questions related to these things. And finally, the last thing is to make sure your website is searchable and looking great on search. So you remember this, right? We've talked about like how do you check whether your site is there on Google search or not. So this is super important, because only if Google knows can accesses only if Google can access your page will you be able to see your pages listed here. If Google can't access your page, not just because of robots issues, there could be a lot of issues like server errors, timeouts, a lot of these things. So you just need to make sure Google can access your page in the first place, because everything else we discussed, if Google can't access your page, we can't show your page on search. And there's also another thing that you can do on how you show up in Google search, which is structured data. So we will go through this in much more detail, but the reason why I'm bringing up structured data is we've already talked about crawling, indexing, and ranking, right? In the ranking piece, one of the biggest ways we are trying to meet our mission goals in terms of making the information that's accessible for everyone also useful is by showing much better search results than much more useful responses for the queries that users are making. For example, like, you know, this is a typical search result, right? This is how a blue link search result is. You have a title, URL, and description, which is great. Like, it's a decent search result, but this is not always helpful, and we can do much better for a lot of queries. So, which is why you see these kinds of results these days. And all of this is possible. Like for example, that recipe result, the video search result, that how to take a screenshot, where you get different steps on how do you take a screenshot and so on. So all of this like rich content within a search result, all of this is made possible through structured data. And in the next presentation, Himani will be covering this. All right, to recap, how does search work? Well, we have three things: crawling, indexing, and ranking. With crawling, Google crawls a lot of pages per day. So we make sure we crawl sensibly by scheduling our crawls. So if you want to make sure Google crawls your site better, make sure you can optimize your site by really structuring your site better and making sure like the internal link structure is good and letting us know within Search Console on what are your priority pages and submitting the good sitemap. And with indexing, make sure you remember that Google has its big index, but it's not limitless. So you always have to make sure you don't have bad content that's like repeating over and over. You want to have like really useful content within your website that Google can index. And finally, with ranking, Google considers a lot of factors, but we also want to show useful responses, which is possible through structured data, which you'll see in the next session. And with the three basic things to keep in mind, which is like make sure you focus on users, which basically means you provide the best possible content for them and also the best possible user experience for them by making sure it's friendly on like multiple devices and it loads fast and quick and it's also safe and secure. And secondly, communicate with us better. You can look at all the resources that we have, like Google Search Console, Google Search Help Community, the YouTube channel and Twitter channel. Just sign up for them and make sure you're up to date with all the latest information. And finally, this is the most important, which is make sure your website is searchable in the first place. Make sure Google can access it and Google can crawl it, because everything else is not really useful if Google can't access your site in the first place. Thank you so much. So if you have any questions, we can take them in the upcoming Q&A later. Or you can, of course, go to the Search Central Help Community and you can search for some questions that may already be there. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Ashish. I think this was a super helpful session. Definitely for people who don't necessarily have a lot of technical background, I think for them, the session will be super helpful. We can now move on to the next session. Yeah, and we have Himani, who will be talking us through Google search features, basically going beyond the blue links, which Ashish was just mentioning. So over to you, Himani.
Thank you, Tani. All right. So I love going back to this slide that Ashish showed us. This is a computer from 1998. I don't know if it rings a bell for you all. Definitely does for me. This brings us back to when, you know, the world started to access information just a fingertip away. And this, from here, I love to take it to today's time, which is my next slide, where you see, you know, information is not available on heavy desktops alone, but it's accessible on your phones from anywhere. Users living in remote areas, living in cities, have access to information equally. And that's why we are talking about the power of organic search today and how you can be present to make sure that you're available for your users right in the moment when they're looking for you. Now, I'll move to the next slide. So how users consume and access information has changed a great deal. During this session, I'll take you through some of the recent changes on how your content can reach your users in a better planned manner. Ashish has already done a great deal of breezing through some of the top items. What we'll do is essentially go to some of them again, but at length, and also look at means of implementing some of those. So here's a summary of what I'm going to cover today. Four key things: structured data, rich results, knowledge panel, Google My Business, and big images on Discover. So let's look at structured data and rich results first. When things began to move to mobile services earlier in 1990s, search results appeared all in blue links, just like on desktop. Obviously, that's not a super friendly experience to users, nor it is ideal for smaller screens that we are all hooked onto these days. What you see today is a more visual experience that I'm showing you on the right. It has images, user reviews, potentially more snackable information that gives you exactly what you need. In real life, this is how it looks like. I'm showing you a recipe query example for now. So in the old days, we used to see a list of blue links that did not necessarily have, you know, steps or visuals. But now what you see is a much more intuitive layout, which is powered by structured data markup. So structured data markup is essentially a predefined set of tags that you can all apply to your web pages to classify your page content. For example, on a recipe page, what are the ingredients? What is the cooking time? What is the temperature, et cetera? You can indicate all of that in structured data, and Google will be able to pick that information and present it in a more user-friendly way. The end result is a better user experience and definitely more engagement with your content. I'm showing you a few more examples besides recipes. We launched how-to example we launched the how-to's markup. And here's an example that you're able to see on my screen in English as well as a regional Indian language. So that's the good news. You can implement markups in not just English, Hindi, but several other regional languages. Here's another example for events. Certain markups such as events and jobs allow search results to appear in a better layout and specifically provide details of that special feature for events, particularly when is the event, how long is the event. Similarly, for FAQs, if you are looking for, say, hotels around you, at the drop of a button, you're able to see exactly information that you need instead of going to the exact link. Similarly, for jobs, if you look up remote jobs, you're able to see exactly which remote job was posted near you in the last few days. You can filter out salary, you can filter out by qualification, by company, by title. So all of these special features really allow you to be more user-friendly and provide information upfront directly to the users on the main search page itself. And once the user finds it relevant, they have the option to click on it and go to your website. So what I've done now is shown you an example of how to structure data markup, FAQs, events, jobs. These are just a few types of structured data markups. There is a whole list that I'm going to talk about now and also give you insight as to how you can go ahead and start implementing these on your markup pages. The one go-to resource is our Google Search Central. That is the starting point for everything related to structured data markup and rich results. If anyone who's new to this, I really recommend you go to Google Search Central. Ashish has talked about it previously. It doesn't only contain information on what markup you can use, but also takes you through a guided process of how you can implement these on your web pages. And I'm going to quickly breeze through the exact steps and allow you time to go through the Search Central. And if you have questions, we can cover those in the Q&A session. So the starting point is just go to Google Search, type Google Search Central, and you should be able to see a link that leads you to Google Search Central. It was formerly called Webmasters Forum, so that may be familiar for most of you. We have recently rebranded it to Google Search Central, and it includes a gallery of all sorts of markups that exist, how these markups look in real life. For instance, a recipe markup versus a job markup, how will they look for your users, for your businesses. Next, it covers a list of all markups that exist. I'm flashing some of those on my screen right now. Next, once you apply these markups, you can instantly test the validity through Rich Results Test Tool. I'll come back to how you exactly apply it, but I'm just taking you through the process for now. A very simple way of testing whether your markup implementation has been done correctly is by going to Rich Results Test Tool. If I were you, I would follow the same process, open a new Google Search tab, just type Rich Results Test Tool, and you'll see a tool open up. I'm flashing how it looks when you test a particular URL. Just pick up your web page URL where you have implemented a markup, put it in the Rich Results Tool, and you'll be able to see whether you have correctly implemented any markup. And if you see, if you've done it correctly, you'll see a green tick mark the way it's showing on the screen right now. And it will also enlist exactly what all markups you've implemented. Next, everybody is interested in this, and the story is half complete without looking at results. So once you've done your implementation, we always recommend that you go back to your Search Console and check up how your markup has been influencing your traffic on the pages that you've marked up. You can easily check impressions, views, how those got impacted, and various other engagement metrics that you may be interested in, time spent by users, if these users are being driven to your web pages through markups. All of this information is available. Next is, it looks like I'm showing you the exact rich results report that you can look at on Search Console. I'll go to the next slide and take a pause here. So we have already covered structured data. What I've covered right now is what structured data markup is. It's a standardized format of meta tags that you can implement on your site to be eligible to show up on rich results on Google. Second, how you can actually access information that allows you to implement these tags. Formerly known as the Webmaster Forum, the Search Central is your go-to guide. Consider it your best friend for everything to understand which markup you can implement, how you can implement it, how you can test it, and finally, how you can look at rich results to see if your implementation has been done correctly, and look at Search Console for tracking metrics. So that's a summary of structured data implementation. I'll take a pause here and invite our guests. For videos in particular, we have Asuka and Daniel with us, who'll cover video search at length and help you understand how you can leverage structured data specifically for video.
Hi there. My name is Asuka, and I cover content partnerships for videos on search and discover at Google. I'm joined by Danielle today, our product manager, and we're here to share with you our current work and some of our latest features. Later in this session, we'll also provide best practices to help you enable your videos to surface on search and discover. Danielle, it's all yours.
Great, thanks, Asuka. As Asuka mentioned, I'm a product manager focusing on videos on search. And as you know, videos are a large and growing format for content creation and consumption on the web. And as users create more video and watch more video, we're seeing video content in all kinds of different verticals, whether that's news or sports or education or any other vertical where people are looking for information, and whether it's a small website or a large platform. So Google indexes millions of sites with videos so that we can surface the right videos for users that are relevant to what they're looking for. This is core to our mission. Google's overall mission is to organize the world's information and make it universally accessible and useful. And so when it comes to videos, this means we aim to deeply understand videos from diverse sources and help users efficiently find the right video or even the right moment in a video that meets their needs. In practice, this means you'll see videos in several different places. Videos appear in the main search results page and also in the dedicated video tab. And in addition, Discover features videos. Discover is the personalized feed of content that has over 800 million monthly active users. To go into a bit more detail, these are some of the video features that you might see in search. Videos can appear in a cluster in the search results page on both mobile and desktop, and these are pages where video is the main content on the page. And in addition, sometimes you'll see video galleries, which represent a page that might have multiple videos, for example, a video playlist. We also surface video results when a page contains both video and some other content like text. So that's what you see here in the third column. The videos tab, as I mentioned earlier, features only video content for a search. And in addition to having more video results, also has other features like related searches to help users find what they're looking for. To go into a couple more specific features, the live badge exists to highlight videos that are live streaming right now. And key moments, which is one of our newer features, lets users jump to a particular moment within a video that's most relevant to what they're looking for. So to share a bit more about how you can get involved and see your videos within these features, I'll hand it back over to Asuka.
Thanks, Danielle. Those are some really exciting features. Our video-forward solutions funnel users to your content to help achieve your growth objectives. First, we display your videos with features on Search and Discover, which allows incremental reach and increases your brand awareness. Specifically on Discover, we push personalized content to users and allow you to gain incremental exposures. Second, our video understanding features with key moments as a flagship help users to find what they're looking for faster. The efficient viewing drives increased engagement and traffic, serving as a snack before the meal. Last but not least, all of our current experiences redirect users to your site to watch the videos, allowing monetization and further actions to occur on your sites. You could continue to leverage your existing analytical tools and the Search Console to evaluate your content performance. We've highlighted a few example metrics for your reference. So, are you ready to take the next steps? The great news is that implementation is easy. To build video search foundations, all you need to do is to make videos on web pages, enable crawling, mark up using structured data, and submit to us via Sitemap API. We've included detailed guidelines via the above link, which is also added to the event website. To get to the next level, two features have additional requirements. First is Live Batch, which we've shared earlier. It highlights live streams either currently live or pre-scheduled on Search's main result page. To enable this, you need to add a broadcast event markup and use our indexing API in addition to the foundational work. Similarly, Key Moments, our flagship video understanding feature, requires an additional markup called Clip, which allows you to highlight key segments in your videos and give them descriptions. This feature is in early access program, so after you implement the markup, please contact us to verify your work before feature launch. Lastly, we'd like to share a couple of tools to guide you through implementation. First is a rich result testing tool that allows you to verify your markup before publishing to your video pages. We also offer a troubleshooting page that includes common FAQs. Second is the Search Console. It helps you to understand how your videos perform on Search and also flags video-related issues. With that, this concludes our session today. Thank you for listening, and please visit videos on Google's Documentation Hub to stay up to date with our latest features and best practices. Thank you, and we look forward to seeing you on Search.
All right. Thank you, Asuka and Daniel. That was a great session packed with a lot of information for videos, and I'm sure a lot of our audiences here found it useful. What I'll do next is take it on from here and move on to our next subject, which is Knowledge Panel. Now, billions of searches take place on Google every year, and a lot of those, as you can imagine, are about people and organizations. What Google does is often shows a box on information that covers about details about people, businesses, things, and places that our users are interested in. We call this a knowledge panel. If you can see it on my screen right now, the box highlighted in green on the right is a knowledge panel. You can, in simple terms, think of it as an auto-generated profile of entities and businesses on Google, which is powered through a knowledge graph engine. What it essentially does is it gives you a quick snapshot of information based on what you have looked up on Search. And today I'm going to talk about how you can benefit from claiming your knowledge panels. So if you're a business or if you're an entity, if you're a person, you may have a knowledge panel of yourself or your business existing on Google, and you can claim it to better engage with your audiences. Here are the steps around how you can claim your knowledge panel on Google. What you should do is, let's say if you are, I'll have to take the example of IPL because we just concluded our recent IPL series. So let's look at the example of Mumbai Indians. Let's say if you're Mumbai Indians and you go on Google search and type Mumbai Indians, you'll see a box on the right. If you people have your phones, feel free to do it alongside. And at the end of the box, there is a claim your knowledge panel button. You can see it in my screenshots here, but you'll not see it if it's already claimed. If you're the right owner of that entity, you can just click on the box and follow the steps to claim the knowledge panel. Now, why we recommend claiming this is to allow you to, one, ensure that your information is correctly presented on knowledge panel. So the good news is, if there's any information that's incorrectly presented, you can give the recommendation to correct it. Once you have claimed it, you have the option to just correct it yourself. Second, there's an option for you to use posts on Google to essentially allow people and organization to connect with what you're doing on a day-to-day basis. Now, if you see the Mumbai Indians KP that I'm flashing on the screen right now on the right-hand corner, towards the end, it has Mumbai Indians on Google. This is a preview of their posts that they're using at this point in time. And this is very simple to use. All you have to do is claim your KP and you'll be able to see an option to post on Google. I'll take a pause here and move to Google My Business. All right. So similar to entities, a lot of searches for businesses initiate on Google. And what we have seen in research is that businesses that have the information complete on Google are twice as likely to be considered reputable by consumers. So we encourage you to claim your Google My Business boxes and ensure that your information is up to date. For instance, make sure that you have a complete panel by adding any information around your business hours, phone number, addresses, things like service numbers, leadership teams, etc. is also what you can add. I'm showing an example right now of a sandwich place on the computer screen, and I'm going to show you a few more examples. So if you see Krishna Kirana store, this is one of the stores close to my houses. And I've shown how their information is up to date. I'm also able to clearly see user reviews, and I'm also able to see their open hours, contact information. On the left side, if you see Google, I'm able to see social media presence. So you are allowed to add your social media handles, be it Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. If you would like to drive traffic from Google to any of these channels, that's also an option. I'll take a pause here. So very similar to posts on KPs. One second, I wanted to show, okay. Yes, I'm showing you the right screen. So similar to knowledge panel posts, you can also put information or posts on your GMB boxes. So for brands and businesses, it is very common these days to create content of their own. What I'm showing you right now is an example of a pizza factory store, Pizza Factory and Brewery. And they often, create their content of how they make recipes, how what's special today. So such updates and photos, videos can directly be updated on search to allow your users to understand what exactly you have to offer. And it's just a great means to be fully covered on search and allow your users a better experience of understanding what your business has to offer. All right, summarizing here. So for people and brands alike, search can be used to represent themselves better. We have already covered how businesses can use GMB and people and entity can use their KPs. This slide is a summary of what we have done thus far. And I'll now move to the last topic of the day, which is big images on Discover. So big images on Discover were launched in 2016, and I'll take a pause here to understand how much do you all know about Discover. If you aren't familiar of Discover, it's likely because we've not done a ton of talking about the surface since it was launched in 2016, as a way to help users to keep up with their interests in an easy and browsable feed. Google launched this on your phone devices. I'm flashing it right now on my screen. If it rings a bell, it's the minus one screen on Android phones, and it's on your Google app on iOS phones and other operating surfaces. I'll take a pause to let you look at the feed and then tell you about particularly images on Discover. All right, hope you've gotten a chance to look at this. And what we are covering today is images that show up on Discover, which allow your content to be better represented. To enable this experience for large images, all you exactly need to do is either opt in via AMP or through a new meta tag that I'm going to cover shortly with you today. It is important for you to be aware of this because, as you can imagine, large images resonate with users, and as a result, they tend to click through to view your content on publisher sites more often. So we always encourage publishers to show up their images on Discover if you're interested in a higher engagement rates. So now coming to implementation. Implementation is fairly straightforward, and there are two easy steps to get started. One is we'll send you a PDF of this document after the session, and that has all the links to developer documentation. But all you need to do is simply apply a meta tag, which is on the left of my screen right now, and then just submit it on as part of your sitemap for reindexing on Google, and your images will start showing up on Discover. It's that easy. And the other option, like I mentioned previously, was for you to opt in AMP to be able to show up on Discover. That's it. That brings me to the summary slide of my presentation. I'll do a quick recap. To allow you to remember everything that we covered. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask the same during the question answer session. We covered number one, how to use structured data and how to check the same on rich results tool. Second, we learned about knowledge panels and how you can claim it. Third, we understood how GMBs can be leveraged, in particular posts on GMBs, to better communicate with your users on search. And fourth and last, we covered how you can showcase big images on Discover for better engagement with your user base. That's it for today for the organic search piece, and I'm going to hand it over to Tane to introduce our next speaker.
Thanks so much, Mani. I think you covered a lot of content within a short span. I think it's super helpful for the users to get aware of that, be it around structured data or knowledge panel. I know it's very important. And Google My Business specifically, I know it's one thing which most of the businesses are trying to come on digital surfaces. So definitely that session is super helpful, and definitely around Discover. So thank you so much for taking the session. All right. So with that, now we'll move on to the next session. Till now, we have heard about how Google works and how you can go beyond just the blue links. Now I'll hand it over to Jyotika, who will talk about Search Console and basically share a few tips on what you should definitely be doing. So just before I hand it over, just a reminder for our audience, please make sure that you're adding all of your questions in the Q&A section. Immediately after this session, we'll be taking all of your questions, and we'll be happy to answer all of those. Thank you so much, and I'll hand it over to Jyotika. Over to you.
Thank you, Tanay, and namaste, everyone. I am so glad we all are here. Ashish and Himani, thank you so much for your presentation so far. It's been completely insightful. Hi, I am Jyotika Kapoor, Senior Strategist. I've been working at Google for the last 4 years, making sure search is clean. So let's talk about Search Console. Search Console is the only tool that we use as a communication platform between you, a webmaster owner, and us on Google Search Console. The best part is it is free to sign up and use. If you have not heard of Search Console, maybe you've heard of webmaster tools. Search Console is a new name for webmaster tools. Well, not new, it's been Search Console for the last 5 years. They are the same tool. And this is how Search Console used to look. But look at the progress that we've made in Search Console to make it easier for you to create fantastic websites that look well in search. You can now access Search Console on mobile devices. We have been focusing on giving actionable insights, better user workflow, as well as better feedback loop. So, why do we talk about Search Console today? Why is it important? Because it is the only, and I can't stress enough, only platform we use to communicate with you regularly about Google organic search. It provides tools and reports to help you succeed on Google search. Well, we all want that, right? Now, for example, you can use Search Console to confirm if your site is showing on the Google search result or not. And don't you wish you have someone to monitor and give you data on how you are doing on Google search? How often does your website show up on search? How many impressions, clicks, CTR, and how are you ranking for different queries? Or which site links to your website? Search Console can help you with that. It can even give you site performance information such as speed or mobile friendliness. We just talked about rich experiences in the last presentation. You can track that on Search Console as well. So when you encounter any issue with your pages, such as indexing, spam, hack, or other issues, you will receive an alert and a recommendation on your Search Console account. So, if you haven't seen it, here is how Search Console looks. Now, coming up to a very important part, 5 things to do. Search Console is not just for developers or someone who deals directly with websites. Let's talk about 5 things that you should do on Search Console as a business owner, marketer, or someone who is not a developer. Remember that in the first presentation, we talked about how we discover your website. We send out Google bots to look for your website. We know your website exists. We index them and we show them on our search results. However, we actually do not know who owns the website. We do have a lot of information to tell you. For example, we know how many times your website shows up on Google search and how many people clicked on it. But we won't know how or who to tell unless you verify to us that you are the real owner of your website. And you definitely don't want your competitor or someone else that is not you to know data about your website. Therefore, you can only see those data points after you verify yourself as an owner of the website. Now, to verify the website, you would have to go to g.co/search console. You can see that on your screen as well to make a note. For verification, you only have to do it just once. And then after, you can just go to the link and log in with your Google account without having to verify again. Now, you can verify the whole domain or each separate site, or there are a lot of ways you can verify your sites. In this presentation, we are assuming that you won't be doing the HTML work. So you can work with developers to do that. If you are on CMS or blogs such as Blogger, Google Sites, or if you're just using Google products such as Google Analytics, you can use that to verify as well. There are many ways to verify yourself as an owner of the website on Search Console. But essentially, what you are doing is proving to us that you actually can edit the website and that you are the real owner of your website. Now, after you verify your website or after your developer has helped you to verify it, one thing you should do is log into your Search Console and set up proper access to relevant people. For example, you might want your marketing team to look at data about what queries your website has been showing up. You can add and remove people's access to Search Console by going to Settings, then go to User and Permission. Now, these accounts do not have to go through verification process anymore. You can also set different permission levels to each account. Moving on, after verifying your website, you can start using Search Console. The first thing you can do is to check and see how Googlebot is seeing your website. You want to make sure that Googlebot can find, access your website, and see the same content as users are seeing. You can do this by using URL inspection tool. In fact, there are a lot of things you can do, and let me walk you through them briefly with screenshots. All you have to do is type the URL on the bar on top. You can check any URL that you own and have verified. Once that's done, you can see what the Googlebot is seeing. So here it says that you find a page and this page is giving a 404 error. Or it means that the page does not exist on that URL. Now, in this case, this page seems to be having a problem with indexing. You can use this tool to debug any issues as they come up. For example, in this case, you can see that the URL is having a 404 issue. This is something you can tell your IT team or developers to have a look at it if that particular page or URL is important to you and you want it to show up on Google. After fixing the issue, you can request reindexing again. Although currently we have disabled the request indexing feature on the URL inspection tool in order to make some infrastructure changes, we expect it to return in the coming weeks. Here, you can also do a live inspection. This is especially useful for any URL which has error or you are unsure if the page is really being fixed. Now, if you have updated the page or if you have new pages or pages that Google has not yet discovered, it's useful to request indexing. Now, remember, the Google bot works on scheduling. So by requesting indexing, you are helping Google bot prioritize content that matters to you. The tool will also suggest any enhancements that is applicable, such as things related to AMP or mobile friendliness. Now, so instead of testing each URL one by one and to look for errors, you can check out the index coverage report. Here, you will be able to find that if there is any error in the URL within certain time range. Moving on. Now, for example, here you might find out that there is a page that Googlebot discovered but is not being indexed. Now, which is a really bad thing. So you can just click in. Here you will see that which is the exact page or the URL that has an issue. You can also inspect URLs and do a live test. The live test that we just spoke about could take a while, so you make sure that you're patient. You know, good things don't come easy. If this is something you understand, or if you have someone take care of this matter for you, you can easily share this error with them by using the share button on the top right. They will receive an email of this report from you and could fix it without you having to explain them so much in detail. Isn't that great? Now, let's take a look at something that is even more related to business front. On Search Console, you have access to lots of data and insights which you could benefit from while trying to reach more people on Google Search. Now, click on Performance from the menu on your left, and this is what you will see. Here, you can get detailed information and also apply filters as per your search. Now, to be honest, the best way to discover this is to just keep clicking, especially if you aren't looking for anything specific, but just browsing for insights in general. So take your time and just keep clicking, and you might find something you didn't know before or something that you can apply for your business online and offline. Make it a habit to check this regularly. You don't want to miss out on any important insight. For now, I can walk you through some of the things you can do on the performance report. Firstly, on the main chart, you can view a few of the charts by a few metrics, which are clicks. Now, this means how many times people click on the link on the result and visit your website. Impressions, which means how many times you show up on Google Search. CTR, which is also called the click-through rate, means the percentage of clicks in relationship to impressions. In short, how many times people click on your result when you show up 100 times. Average position, which is where you show up. Whether you show up on the first page, of the first result, second, or so on. On the frequently asked question is, what do people type in Google search for your website to show up? Well, you can check out the top queries that brings people to your website in the detailed information section below the graph. Now, in this example, you show up most for the query, nice t-shirt. From here, you might be wondering, oh, and where do those people land on? Which exact page from my website show up on the search results for that query? You can then click on the query you want to know about. The filter on that query will be applied, which you can see on the top. Since you want to know which page shows up most for that query, click on the pages. And there you have it. The page that shows up most for the query, nice t-shirt. Another interesting thing you can do is to compare traffic and other metrics between image search and web search. Now, this is especially useful for certain businesses that require useful users to browse pictures a lot instead of reading text. You might find out useful insights from here. For example, if you sell clothes and most people look at pictures instead of reading, you might find that majority of your traffic came from image search. Then you might decide to optimize or invest more on image search or images on your website in general. Usually, usability and user experience on the web are really, really, really important in terms of engagement and revenue. This is because users have a short attention span and users hate bad websites. If you are wondering if your website is doing well in terms of speed or mobile usability, you can look at report under enhancements. Another thing that you should definitely look at is Core Web Vitals. Core Web Vitals are a set of metrics focusing on loading performance, interactivity, and visual stability. And these metrics will become a ranking signal on Google organic search results next year. Just for more example, here, we also see the status of AMP URLs that have been crawled, and it shows which valid URLs or which have errors. For actionability's sake, you can share this easily with your developer or someone who works on your website, so they can improve these things accordingly. And you don't have to explain too much in detail. It is also important to note that sharing this with someone who is not a user of your account, the person will have to access only to this page and no other page on the search console. After they have done improving stuff, you will have the ability to check how the website is performing after the improvement by using the immediate validation function. This validation will start immediately and tell you if the suggestions have failed or passed. Basically, whether the suggested actions have been fixed or improved or not. Now, we talk a lot about rich snippets in the last presentation. So if you end up implementing some of them, which I really, really recommend you to consider doing, you can come onto Search Console to check if the implementation was okay or if there is an error as well as the performance of the rich results. You can view each of the rich results separately as well, since one website might have a few types of them useful and end up implementing a few types. Lastly, being on Search Console basically is like you having many more pair of eyes to help you monitor issues on your website. You have teams who will look out for spam or security issues on your website. If you are on Search Console, we will notify you whether Google discovers any issue on your website. More importantly, we will also suggest ways to fix and prevent issues in the future. Now, I just want to recap whatever we have done in this presentation so far. First, verify websites and manage user permissions. Second bit, check how Googlebot sees your website using URL inspection tool. Third important point is check index coverage and tell your developers. Fourth, check and optimize your website performance. Fifth, and very important, watch out for alerts. Thank you everyone for listening and hope you all will verify your websites today. Handing it over to Tanay now. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jyotika. Thanks for walking us through the Search Console tool as well as sharing all the 5 tips. I'm sure many of the audience will definitely find it very useful. Cool. So with that, we come towards the end of our presentation. We can move on to the Q&A section now. I would recommend all of you to add your questions in the Q&A section below. And I'll give you a few seconds. You'll also see a survey form towards the right hand side. So please make sure you fill the survey as well in the meantime when we start the Q&A questions. So moving on to the Q&A section, that's it.